early reports suggest Israel may have carried out an operation in Iran following the drone and missile attack last weekend. So far, Israel has not released an official statement claiming responsibility, but Downing Street says it does have the right to defend itself.
But Iranian state media is downplaying the seriousness, saying three drones were intercepted by its air defence systems over the province of Isfahan.
Well, let's cross now to Tel Aviv, where former Israeli MP Ksenia Svetlova joins us. What are you hearing on the ground from where you are? What are the latest developments?
Good morning. So, first of all, I have to tell you that there is this sense of satisfaction in the Israeli political class. It seems that Netanyahu achieved what he wanted. He showed that he can retaliate. And he's not bounded by all of these pleas by his regional and international allies. But at the same time, he didn't want this all-out war in the Middle East. It seems to be, from what we see from the Iranian response, it's not about to happen, at least not now. There is no special alert in Israel. There is no emergency state in Israel. People are just, you know, continuing with the Friday. It's a free day. Cafes are full, people are outside, there is no sense of something dramatic happening.
Yeah, the way you're describing this, it almost sounds like a sort of face-saving exercise for Benjamin Netanyahu to satisfy domestically that he's not letting Iran get away with it, but also not being seen to escalate this crisis. Do we see this as an escalation or a de-escalation, given how far this is from the sorts of things that were being talked about in the Israeli War Cabinet?
Well, absolutely. You know, first of all, there are already a few responses by the most far-right ministers in Israel's cabinet that they describe this response as mute, not enough, something that will not satisfy the need to really retaliate. These are the voices of the ministers Ben-Gvir and Smotrich, who were calling for a very harsh blow on Iran, even at the cost of starting a regional war. It seems that the voices of the most moderate parts of this coalition, meaning Minister of Defense Benny Gantz, Mr. Minister of Defense Yoav Gallant, and also Minister Benny Gantz, who supported some kind of response, but I think that given their good relations for both of them with the United States and other allies of Israel, their voice, you know, that was the decisive voice in forming and shaping this kind of response to the very outstanding Iranian attack about a week ago on Israeli cities.
And of course, Benjamin Netanyahu very clear with Lord Cameron that it is Israel's right to strike back. We now know there has been no damage to nuclear sites, according to the International Atomic Energy Agency, just in terms of where we go. Iran now is saying it has no plan for immediate retaliation. Are you hoping this does actually draw a line under it? Because Israel has to, or was seen to have to, respond in some muted, measured way. Do you think that's the end to this?
Well, I certainly hope that this is the end for this current episode that started with the elimination of some Iranian generals in the diplomatic mission of Iran in Damascus. But I do believe that the hostility with Iran and the ongoing war, it is a war. It is not the traditional war, but because it's happening between proxies and not necessarily the territory of either Israel or Iran, it will go on. And there are, of course, a lot of suspicions in Israel that Iran might want to break through very soon with its nuclear program and escalate the enrichment of the uranium, given the threats that were flying in the air, and understanding that perhaps this episode is over, but there can be another one soon.
And that's the point, isn't it? I mean, the IAEA saying that nuclear facilities in Iran are safe were not targeted, because it follows that very concerning warning from Iran this week. You attack our nuclear facilities, we'll attack yours. That certainly would be an escalation, and an escalation that would have global impact.
Well, the language on both sides was very harsh and dramatic. And the Iranians, I just have to mention that, I think they admitted for the first time yesterday through one of their officials that they are ready to change their nuclear strategy. meaning if until now they claimed that, you know, that's all for the peaceful purposes and so on, you know, the world did not believe them so much. But then again, you know, they never admitted that they wanted the nuclear program for the military purposes. I think for the first time yesterday we heard from the Iranian official that was quoted in AP and other news agencies that they might use it to strike at Israel back at the nuclear facilities, that Israel nuclear facilities are uncovered. They know where they are and they will not be shy of hitting them, and perhaps also, you know, in the future using their nuclear power as well. You know, this is what I call a serious escalation. This is something that the world should focus on right now. And use the time that we have. We don't know how much we have right now, because we know that Iran is just a couple of months away, you know, from the bomb, in order to stop this, stop, you know, from the further nuclearization of the Middle East, because the consequences can be unprecedented.
And just in terms of brokering a deal between Israel and Hamas, Qatar is instrumental in that. Qatar is reassessing its role as a mediator. It says that it's being exploited. It feels undermined. Are you confident that a two-state solution can come about?
Well, I will just have to tell you a few words about Qatar. You know, I do know that, you know, this mediation between Israel and Hamas elevates Qatar's position in the world globally. They became basically the hub of diplomatic activity in the past few months. I do not believe very much, you know, that they will just give it away, because they heard a few harsh words from some of the US congressmen or Israeli politicians. In fact, they heard them also before. They will continue. Now, the big question is whether they can provide a deal. And this is something that it puzzles many, especially in Israel, because we've heard time and again Qatari officials saying, well, you know, it's over the corner, it's really close, we are getting there, and then nothing happens. We are still in square one. Regarding the two-state solution, well, unfortunately, I can tell you, you know, and being an ex-member of the opposition, I didn't think that Netanyahu was interested in this kind of solution before, 10 years ago when I was in the Knesset, but also today with this most far-right coalition that he has, or maybe they have more grip on him than he has over them. I don't think that this is the direction. Yeah, I think that we are getting further away from the two-state solution, unfortunately, because indeed this is the only solution that can bring some stabilization and peace and security to both sides and, in fact, to the whole of the Middle East.
Thank you very much indeed for joining us. That's Ksenia Svetlova, former Israeli Member of Parliament.